Here we are again, episode 28 of the Official Queen podcast. This is the Simon Lupton Greg Brooks interview, part two. As I mentioned in the previous one, we discussed their book, Freddie Mercury, A Life in His Own Words, and we just carried on going and talked about all sorts of other bits and bobs. Because I had them there, I might as well have made use of them. So here we are. It's kind of like a bit of a bonus, really. Part two, the Official Queen podcast. Crack on. Just probe into other stuff, projects. Mm. So Simon, you kind of...
Probe Simon.
So you've had two other sort of Queenie projects recently.
Yeah.
Bejar Ballet.
Love the Bejar Ballet.
And the Show Must Go On documentary, yep. haven't you? So they're both out. Both out there now.
Gone. Yeah. Yeah, no, the Bejar Ballet was a real labour of love. In the sense it's that bit of the Queen canon that seems to get largely overlooked. Mm-hmm. And it was really nice to delve back into it. And it is an extraordinary piece of work, and it's an extraordinary time in Queen's story. Mm. As you know, they performed at the opening night with Elton John, and that was the last time that John Deacon performed live with the band, and so that's a significant moment. And it was the first time that Queen's music had been used for a completely different art form, you know, with the blessing of the mm-hmm. band. And it was, the great joy was working with Lynn Wake, who was our director on it, who was a former member of the Royal Ballet Company. She was a dancer, and she still works with the Royal Ballet and the Royal Opera House and so forth. And her understanding of what the Bejar Ballet meant as a ballet, which I had never got from watching it, because I'm uneducated in that way. And I think a lot of Queen fans perhaps are, it was a real eye-opener. So I really enjoyed working on that. And as she sort of unpicked how Maurice Bejar had interpreted and completely changed some of the songs. I mean, the example that we feature in the documentary is You Take My Breath Away.
Right.
Which I'd always imagined was Freddie talking about when you fall in love with someone and they take your breath away. Mm. But this was interpreted about death stalking someone.
Oh.
And death is coming to literally... take your breath away, and this woman is running from death. And okay, that's probably not what Freddie meant,
but
why not, you know, interpret that into the song? And that's what Maurice Bejar did.
Very interesting.
And it's all about, you know, dying too young and AIDS,
yeah.
and that, you know, AIDS is stalking these people to take their breath away. So it was a real education for me, and I loved working on that. And it's out on Blu-ray and DVD, and it's I urge any fans who have never engaged with it, do, because it really is a fascinating piece of work.
And then brought bang up to date then, the Show Must Go On documentary.
Yeah, which was sort of the Queen and Adam Lambert story, which again mm-hmm. just sort of traces that journey from where Bohemian Rhapsody movie leaves us, really. So we sort of open a little bit further along at the Freddie Mercury tribute concert, and with Brian and Roger talking very sort of openly and about the fact that for them, they thought the journey was over and that was it. And they couldn't imagine a life without Freddie. And then this series of events happens.
Yeah.
Things start to sort of fall into place. They reconnect with the audience. They see that there is still a love and a demand for them to perform live. And so then it's, how do you do that? And there's the Paul Rodgers era, which was fascinating. And then at the same time, you've got this journey of this young man who, in 1992, when the world was saying goodbye to Freddie at Wembley Stadium, there's this young man in San Diego going to see Wayne's World and seeing that clip and going, who the hell are they?
Yeah, that's the thing. Even though working closely with the band and then the Queen and plus Adam Lambert tours and all that sort of thing, I didn't have a chance to catch up with Adam's story. I knew he was an American Idol.
Yeah.
And suddenly it was, boom, they're playing together. That's worked. Let's try it out. Eight tours later, whatever it is. So actually, when I watched it, I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's the guy I know.
So, yeah.
It's
an
interesting story because you interview his mother and his father. And I really enjoyed it. I wasn't expecting it to be anywhere near as in-depth, so I was really enjoyed it.
There's a lovely story that we couldn't fit in. We didn't get enough around it. There was no footage to support it. But Adam actually auditioned for We Will Rock You when it opened in Las Vegas. And he didn't get through.
Connections everywhere, isn't
there? So he didn't get in front of Brian and Roger. He never sang for Brian and Roger. He didn't make it through. And I think at the time he was like absolutely devastated because he was, you know, he loved the songs or something. But fate played a hand, because I think if he had have got through and become a Galileo,
they wouldn't have.
They could never have done it. I don't think the public would have accepted a Galileo.
No, they said, "Oh, he has, and he does have that background to him." But that's too obvious, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, we plucked him from one of our productions. Yeah,
absolutely. So it's you know, fate played a hand. It was almost like it was being guided to that moment on the American Idol final, where again, just by sheer chance,
it wasn't a setup, was it?
No, not at all. It was they decided Queen they wanted Knight. Queen to play in the finale, but no one knew that Adam would necessarily be in that finale. Mm. And then suddenly, this magic starts to happen, and the rest is.
Those interviews you mentioned of Roger and Brian were new interviews, aren't they?
Yeah. We filmed them in Las Vegas when they were doing their residency over there, and spoke to Adam as well. It's a lovely story, and when I showed it back to Brian, he sort of said it's fascinating for him to look back and see all of those things that have happened to him and Roger since 1991, and realise that they've all sort of come together
to get to that point,
to a point, because they're isolated incidents at the time.
Of course they are.
But they all contributed to where we are.
Yeah, the little projects that end and start, but they exactly. And Greg, the 2020 Queen calendar,
is
out now, obviously, showcases your now not so mythical I Want It All book, because it's been spoken about a lot.
That is a fair description.
But no one's really seen anything or heard anything, but now, parts of it are literally out there.
Earlier this year, probably March or even earlier, I was on the cusp of finishing the design of it with the designers, and we were getting some way to, and then the Freddy book sort of came up, and then Simon and I spent 8 months odd, as well as doing other full-time jobs on the side, and in the middle of the night and in the weekend we did the Freddy book, but it did put back I Want It All.
So I Want It All, just so those who don't know, is this Queen memorabilia merchandise collection book, which is based on...
Well, it started life as 40 years of Queen memorabilia, but now it's 50... Now it is, honestly...
Telling, isn't it?
Because it's 14 years down the line since we did come up with the concept in 2004. So now it's basically 50 years of Queen memorabilia. When I say Queen, I mean Queen with Freddie.
Yes.
And not solo.
Yeah.
So it's starting right from the Delaney session... acetate that Brian retains from 71 or 72, right up to the very latest box sets we've put together for Rainbow and Hammersmith and the coloured vinyl Queen Experience.
Yeah.
What's it called? The Queen
Studio.
Studio collection. So everything you've ever wanted to see, basically, of Queen memorabilia, from scarves and badges and t-shirts and tour passes and CDs and vinyl, everything you can imagine, all the novelty craziness as well.
So it's a pictorial book, obviously, but is there context of the text, obviously, helping people move along through it?
It's more or less chronological.
Yeah.
I say more or less because when you come to, say, the fifth chapter of A Night at the Opera, you see everything to do with Night at the Opera. So you start from 1975, Night at the Opera, but then there might be the 30th anniversary.
I see. Okay, so that's how it's broken up, is it, by album?
I figure you want to see all the stuff to do with Night at the Opera in a similar section.
Yes.
You know, so that's more or less what we did. It's a 450-page book. It's quite large. It's full colour. It has open-out, fold-out areas, so you know, we do eight times in the book where you open the page, and instead of having just the two page spread, you can fold it into, open it out into four pages, so you'll see all the Queen picture discs on a four page spread. All the Queen tour passes is another one. Another thing I did was Japanese singles and albums, so it's really nice. It's been, I spent a lot of time, a lot of care on it over 12, 14 years, photographing probably 4,000 things.
Wow.
So there's so many things now that we have, because of the prolonged time, it can't all possibly fit into one book, so we're very likely going to do a Queen live memorabilia book.
God, you're always talking a sequel before it's even out.
Oh, yeah. No,
it's called I Want It All Again.
I won't hold you down to a release date, but have you got a rough idea when you want it to?
Well, it's supposed to be early to mid, but it will be really, because as you say, the calendar's come out, and it says on the back, from the forthcoming book, I Want It All. So we have to have it next year, and I've been teasing people with it on Facebook, so it has to come, and there's no reason why it couldn't come out and say April, but I need to get it out there, because there's so much to it. To answer your little question, there is some text, not a great deal of text, a few funny stories, a few anecdotes that I put in there about collecting and strange things that I found in Brian's collection, and like when he brought in a suitcase and we couldn't open because he'd lost the key. And we looked at this case in the office for about 2 months before we finally managed to get it open and found all this Queen merch from Japan in 81, where he stashed all this stuff in on that day, closed it, lost the key.
It hadn't
been opened for 32 years. So it's a nice book, nice text. There'll be stuff from Brian and hopefully from Roger as well, because he's Queen. Lots of captions and lots of photos, and tell the whole story. Everything you've ever seen, from bubblegum cards to all kinds of crazy things like the trout that sings We Will Rock You.
It's sort of the book that you're going to look at once and then you look at it again and see a thousand different things. Oh, you just keep going back to him.
Well,
you
know? I mean, for example, we, with the help of three or four fans, most of them from Holland, I gathered together all the Queen passes that everybody had. So my own ones, Brian's ones mainly, everybody else's. So we had, in the end, 160 backstage passes from all the Queen gigs, and we laid them all out for a 4-page spread. And you could spend an hour looking at that. You could easily, because it's so fascinating, you know, all the different colours and shows and the different badges. I think you could, if you're a really big Queen fan. I showed it to Jim Jenkins recently. I showed him the badges, and he was saying, "Oh, that's Europe '79. That's the badge from the press kit from the Saarbrücken gig in July '79." And you know, I've never seen that before. And he said, "Where did you get that?" I said, "Well, an American fan happened to have the press kit, and it's got the badge." Yeah, so there's a lot of stuff. It depends on how long you want to spend looking at it.
Yeah.
Just the badges, you could spend an hour.
So it starts in 1972.
Well, actually, we have got posters from 71 is the earliest poster. So it begins there,
and it
ends with the Delaney acetate. Then the first Queen album and the first single. We basically cover the single and the album, and then the concerts from that time, and then everything else from that time.
Okay, and it ends where? So where?
It ends up with the most recent thing we can do. So, for example, we're working right now on the Miracle box set.
I was going to come to that, so
Now, if we can get a prototype ready in time, I might leave 2 or 3 pages blank at the end of the book. So right at the last minute, we can add that.
Fantastic.
So I'll include whatever I can right up until the last minute where it has to go off to press.
Oh, God.
So everything up to now is covered.
So between you, movies, books, documentaries, TV shows, reissues, keeps life pretty interesting for you, doesn't it, really?
It does, yeah. We're grateful for it in many ways. And I think what's interesting, I've seen it through my kids, is that rather than it's just me banging on about this old band that they need to listen to, there's stuff that they can actually physically engage with. For them, the first thing was the musical. They were able to go and they were able to watch it. It was live. They could experience it. And then subsequently, it's been going to see Queen and Adam when they've been in town.
I have a very similar thing. Just this weekend gone, I took my two girls to go and see We Will Rock You at Southend Cliffs Pavilion
because
it's a new production. And I told them the day we were going, they went, "Oh, why does it always have to be Queen?" Right? As soon as they got there, bang, straight into it.
Yeah.
Whatever they said. They were just teasing me, but they up and going at it. They absolutely loved it, and they've also seen Queen Adam Lambert. And
it's because it's something physical that they can go and experience. Yeah. And all right, it's not the original Queen, but that's their way in, and then they dive back into the catalogue and listen to Freddie and watch him on DVD. But it's sort of, and it's because it's still alive and living and breathing, it's keeping people like Greg and I busy.
Yeah, I just hear from my kids' rooms, not necessarily songs, but things like the AOs just suddenly come. I mean, they're only young, my kids, but they don't, not necessarily songs, it's like, AO! And that's it for the day. But it's funny that it's been ingrained in them. And I don't push it on them at all, really. I don't really push it on them. There's things that they just sort of sucked in. And it's funny.
I mean, new people come to Queen music and Freddie music through so many different ways now, more than there's ever been, whether it's through the internet or social media or from a Deo they've heard on a commercial or some other radio ad or something on the radio or just the standard music. There's so many places and ways that you can encounter Queen now, isn't there? You know, it doesn't matter where these people get their interest, whether it's an Adam Lambert concert or a Will Rock Who show or the Queen Extravaganza or a tribute band in your local pub. All these people are coming to Queen, and now, of course, the movie.
Mm. So we touched on the Miracle. I was just saying, you know, there has been a recent announcement about the Miracle box set, Jim Beach. Everyone know in Montreal what's going on. What does that album bring back for you? I know we probably will discuss this further down the line at some point. But
well, I'll say so.
1989, sure, Greg Brooks.
Well, then I'll hand over to Simon. But I was 23 then. And so, for example, before the album came out, I went to all my local record shops, I remember, and there were local record shops.
Oh, nice. Good old days.
There were three or four of them, and I said, when you get all your Miracle promo stuff for the windows, can I put my name on it? And they said, Christ, you're a bit ahead of the game, aren't you? It's not even in yet. I said, no, because last time you did a Queen album, I came in on the day, and somebody had already put their name on it.
Yeah.
So when it comes, I said, yeah. So I remember coming back a week later, this is my memory of the Miracle, and there was this big 1 meter by 1 meter massive card promo in the window, and I went in, and my name was on the back of it. So I remember, you know, buying the albums and the album and the single. It was exciting because I loved the cover for a start. I loved it.
It's iconic cover, really.
I really did. I loved I Want It All, the first single. And I thought, oh Christ, you know, the band, they've been away for 3 years. They're back with this great
monster of a song, yeah.
And even my friends that at work who wanted to dislike Queen said, well, I have to say, that album cover is fab and the new single is brilliant. And the band sound and look great. And it was just exciting time.
Where did you put your 1 meter by 1 meter Miracle card? I think I
was
card.
Still living at home. That was the last year I was living at home.
Yeah.
So in the bedroom. And my mum said, where the hell is that going to go? You know, I said, oh, in the bedroom. And in the bedroom where I'd already ruined all the wallpaper with posters for the last 15 years. But actually, she thought it was interesting as well. She said, how did they do that?
That's what they look like.
Yeah.
It's amazing what they can
do. So what's your memory of Miracle?
My memory of the Miracle is, well, remember the context of it as well, was that we hadn't had anything for 2 years as Queen, had we? We'd had the Barcelona album, but we'd been starved of new stuff from the band, and all these rumours flying around that they were past it and they, you know, that was it and they were dinosaurs and so forth.
Nothing new to offer.
And then they came back with this song, you know, I Want It All. And I remember the video because it was just the four of them stood there and rocking out, and Freddie looked great, he had the beard, and they, you know, they just rocked it. And, and it was a real sense of they're back and they've gone back to their roots, you know, it was great. But the first time I heard The Miracle was at the Queen Fan Club convention.
There you go.
At Camber Sands. And we all sat in the ballroom and we had a fan premiere. It was the exclusive premiere. And they showed the video of I Want It All. And then about five times that evening just played the whole album through. And we all just sat there and listened to it.
You could in those days. Just someone would sit there and record it all, and you know.
Well, people were, you know, but they for their own purposes. They weren't going to stick it out on on internet, which didn't
exist.
Great
stories, though.
Yeah, so there was no Facebook or even YouTube.
But it was lovely to sit in a big room with 1,000 other fans and share that.
But I suppose you two are going to start having to pick through that at some point or get involved.
Hopefully, yeah.
Yeah, well, Simon's already looking at the video aspect. Me, Chris and Justin and Josh are looking at audio. Me and Richard Gray looking at the book and text and photos and memorabilia. The whole team is in miracle mode.
Yeah, yeah. And we've just come out of never boring mode. So what do you make of the new version of Mr. Bagel?
Simon?
Well, I mean, it's incredible. I mean, you just hear his vocals on that. I mean,
they probably are some of his best vocals, yeah, I personally think.
Absolutely. And I think it's great that it's being able to be done at a level that he perhaps would have aspired to, but for technical reasons or practical reasons couldn't at the time. There's some brilliant songs.
There are.
On that. I've always had a real soft spot for that record. I really have. I often do try and pick out the albums by artists that weren't necessarily the loved ones or the ones that weren't as successful. So I always do that. I always try and find those, because if you can't find something in those, the other stuff, I don't know. I could listen to Led Zeppelin 4 all day, but I've done it.
Yeah.
So I go and listen to Presence, or with the Rolling Stones, I go and listen to Undercover rather than X on Main Street. I just try and find.
Yeah.
And with Bad Guy, that's my Queen thing. I know it's not Queen, but it's that kind of one of those that sits there. Like I love Hot Space.
It's underrated, Bad Guy. People hopefully revisit it now. There's some really good songs on here.
It sounds like some rounded and warmer and now.
It's the most autobiographical, I think. Of Freddie. I think there's a lot of him in those songs. I mean, there are in a lot of Queen songs as well, of course. But there I really do think he's laying himself bare, as it were.
Yeah, that's true. He really is. There's a lot to hear, and you should, some of those songs you can listen two or three times and, I get it.
What he's trying to say.
It sounds great now. It sounds better than it's ever sounded.
Absolutely. Well, I think that's it. Thank you. Chaps, I think that's...
That's been fun.
Yeah, we've touched on all sorts of bits and bobs. I think we may well make this into a part one and a part two. In a book at one end and all the other stuff at the other end. So,
that would be nice.
Exactly. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Neil. Good to talk to you.
Toodaloo.
Take good care of what you've got, my father said to me. You big disgrace, kicking your can all over the place, singing, "We are."